Hello friends, welcome to WowAIS. Welcome to this discussion on Economy PT 365 summary. This is part 1 of the lecture where we are going to start with the PT 365 economy summary, and in this lecture we are going to discuss the first chapter. Okay, so how to make best use of this lecture? The best way is just put the summary, the Economy PT 365 summary, which we are providing at free of cost in the JPEG format from the Telegram channel. Just put that in front of you and just listen to this lecture. So this will help you in your revision and also to understand things in a much clearer way. Okay, if you don't have the summary, don't worry. The details of the Telegram channel I have given in the description. Just join the Telegram channel and you can get the summary from there. Or else you can do one more thing. You can just put the PT 365 document in front of you and just underline and mark the important things which we are discussing, and this will help you in your revision. Okay, now let's begin with the lecture. So this is the first part where we are going to discuss the first chapter, that is fiscal policy. The fiscal policy is basically nothing but the policy of the government of India, and you can say this is the economic policy of the government of India in order to ensure that the country move forward and ensure the growth of the country, growth of the GDP in fact. Okay, so this fiscal policy, basically this is mentioned, this is actually implemented through the budget, you can say. And the first topic here we have is the status paper on the government debt. The central government released the debt management strategy for 2019-20 to 2020-21. And this debt management strategy, actually this is the 9th edition, and this will guide the borrowing plan of the government. This will guide the borrowing plan of the government, because as you know, borrowing is very much important for the government in order to reduce, or you can say to meet the mismatch between the revenue it is receiving and the expenditure it has to incur, revenue and expenditure. And as you know, the difference between this revenue and expenditure is nothing but the fiscal deficit. And also this debt management strategy, this will ensure the government's financial requirements and the payment obligations it has to meet. And the main aim, or you can say the main target, is all the borrowing that the government has to do, all the borrowing that the government has to do, this has to be done at very low cost. So to ensure that the government take money at low cost, there has to be a certain plan, and this plan is given in this debt management strategy. So now, what is the significance of managing the debt? The significance. So the government debt impacts investors' confidence and fiscal capabilities, because as you know, the government, if it is taking more debt, then the investors' confidence will reduce, because the rating, the AAA rating and other ratings which are given by the global rating agencies like the Fitch and others, that will reduce. And when this reduces, the investors will have less confidence in the government's capability. So this will have a major impact on the investments that the country is receiving. So this is very important. And also, if government is taking more money, or government is borrowing more money from the market, then what is happening? This is leading to a crowding out effect. So crowding out effect means money not available to the private sector, not available to the private sector for investment. Because if government is taking more money from the banks and all, the banks will not have money to lend to the private sector. So this is called crowding out effect. So this crowding out effect will be there on the private sector more. And also it will lead to fiscal repression of the commercial banks. It will lead to inflation. And also there will be exchange rate risk and high taxation in the future. Because if the government is borrowing more money today, so that means on a later date the government has to return. If the revenue is not increasing and the expenditure is remaining same, then what will happen? The debt which the government has to take, it will pile up. So debt will pile up because revenue is not increasing. So when the debt keeps on piling, so in future what will happen is the taxes will rise, because the inflation is rising and the value of rupee is reducing. So then taxes will be rising in future. So the whole thing will lead to a crisis in the economy. Okay? So managing the debt is very much important. So for this, the government will be following a sustainable debt management. So central government, sustainable debt management, the government will be following. And for this only, there is actually an idea to set up this public debt management agency. So this dedicated statutory body, so idea was mooted, but still it was not set up. It has to be a statutory body is the proposal. The Public Debt Management Agency will be managing the debt of the government. It will manage both the external debt and the domestic debt. External debt means the debt which the government is taking from the international institutions or other countries. Okay? And this will be merged under one roof. The first step in this direction was taken in 2016 when Public Debt Management Cell was created as an advisory body. So don't take it as something statutory, because it is just an advisory body. It doesn't have much powers also. So this is created within the budget division of Ministry of Finance. So this is mere an advisory body. But currently, if you see the management of external debt, it is done by the Department of External Affairs under the Ministry of Finance. Sorry, Department of DEA under the Ministry of Finance, and the internal debt is managed by the RBI. Sorry, the internal debt is managed by the RBI. Okay, so if you see this government's medium-term debt management strategy, so this has basically three pillars. It is based on three broad pillars which will guide the central government. The first one is low borrowing cost, because the borrowing cost has to be low. When the borrowing cost is low, the government can incur more expenditure on the useful things, on the capital and other fronts. And first main thing in the low borrowing cost is long maturity profile. That means long maturity profile of the debt portfolio, because the government can take long time to return the money. Because when the government can take long time to return the money, the interest rate will be low. And also the government won't have the burden to return the money at a low, at a nearer future. The burden also will reduce on the government. And the second one, if you see, interest rate rationalization on PF securities, etc. So even the interest rate rationalization is done on other small savings schemes. So this interest rate rationalization, this will help to reduce the interest rates that the on which the government is taking. So reducing interest rates or taking the loan at best interest rate, okay, this is very much important for the government. Because if the interest rate rationalization is done, that means giving high interest rate when the market is good and giving low interest rate and when the market is not good, and managing the interest rate. So the interest rate will be volatile, or you can say the interest rate will be fluctuating. This is the actual term. Okay. So the interest rate will vary depending on the market conditions and other things. So this is called interest rate rationalization, because a fixed interest rate for a long maturity period loan is definitely going to impact. Because let's say the term of loan is 10 years, for example 10 years, and the interest rate today the government is taking at interest rate of 7%, but later on after a couple of years the interest rate has fallen to about 5% in the market, then the government is going to face the loss. So a fixed interest rate is definitely going to impact the government. So it has to be, the interest rate has to be rationalized. And also advising other departments of MEA for the best term of external loans. So when the external loans are taken, then the government has to ensure that this DEA basically, which take care of the external loans, it has to ensure that the loans which are taken are at the best interest of the government. And the second one you have is the risk mitigation. So benchmarking indicators like external debt, which has to be done to minimize the risk. Because risk is something that will impact the whole economy. So whatever the loan the government is taking, there has to be some indicator against which the loans has to be measured. Because if the government take excess of loan and excess of interest rate every year the government has to pay, then this is going to impact the whole economy. Next, you have the market development, where there has to be transparency in borrowing and conduct the investor interaction with stakeholders and issuing instruments. Because if the borrowing is not transparent, then the investors will not know from where the money is going and from where they can get the money, because there will be crowding out effect in the market, which you have discussed. And also there has to be some benchmarks to ensure that everything is measured in the economy. And also these benchmarks will ensure the tenors to enhance the investor investment participation and liquidity, because only when the benchmarks are clear and then the investors will be very clear basically. So when the investors will be very clear, then the investment participation will increase in the economy. And support to the domestic investor base and calibrated opening of the government securities to the foreign investors. So domestic investors has to be given more support, because when the domestic investors are given more support, then more investments can come in, and also the domestic investors can take advantage of the current investment regime. Okay, so this is the basically the three broad pillars. So next one, if you see India's performance on indicators of debt sustainability, So here if you see the gross fiscal deficit, which is nothing but the deficit as percentage of GDP, is declining since 2012-2013. But in 2020 and in 2021, we are witnessing the increase in the fiscal deficit. And this increase is because of the effect of COVID. Because the COVID, what it has done is, it has increased the expenditure of the government, and also there is decrease in the revenue, the tax revenue and others which the government is receiving. So because of this, there is huge impact on the economy. So the gross fiscal deficit, which was on declining trend from 2012-13, is now increasing. So there is no fixed trend you can see. So the trend is varying. So in exam, if a statement is given that the gross fiscal deficit has been on the decreasing trend from 2012-13, this will be a wrong statement, because recently we are witnessing an increase in the gross fiscal deficit. Next, the short-term debt is within the safe limits and stabilized after some rise in 2005 to 2012. So the short-term debt is within the safe limits, you can say. Next one is the strategy of elongated maturity to reduce rollover risk. Because as I told already, when the maturity period is long, when the maturity period for the loans is long, then the burden to return the money will be less. The burden to return money in near future will be less. So the government has ample time to raise the revenue so that the loans will be returned. Okay, next one. Most government debt is in fixed interest rate and floating internal debt only 0.9% of the GDP in 2019. So there is an advantage for the fixed interest rate. So there will be a clear picture in mind of the government. And market won't impact. Market has no impact on the loans that the government has taken. Because there are pros and cons on the impact of market on the loans. Because sometimes what will happen is the interest rate will decrease in the market. So that time the government is going to face the loss. But there is also a risk, because sometimes what will happen is that the interest rate will increase a lot. So when the interest rate increase a lot, the government has to incur extra expenditure, which will be a burden on the government. So there is a risk involved in this. So now currently what the government is doing is, government is avoiding this kind of a risk. And most of the loans that the government is taking, they will be in the form of fixed interest rate only. And if you see the floating interest rate, it is only 0.9%. So if there is a statement tomorrow in the exam, government has most debt in the floating interest rate, this will be wrong, because most of the debt that the government has is in the form of fixed interest rate. And next one, if you see, the less share of external debt and there is less currency risk. So the government debt, if you see, most of the debt is in the form of internal debt and not the external debt. So as the external debt is less, there is a less currency risk. Okay? Because as you know, the exchange rate in the international market vary a lot. And this exchange rate variation will impact the loans that the government is taking on the international front. Okay? So this is the important thing. Next one, the state government debts has decreased, okay, over time. You can say because of this FRBM Act. But recently, even the state government loans or the state government debts also has increased because of the COVID-19. And the share of public debt increased with overall debt portfolio of the state government, which is 19.1% of the GDP. Okay. And the share of the market borrowing increased and from National Small Scheme Fund declined. So government now, what it is doing is, it is mostly taking money from the market and not from the National Small Scheme Fund, because the National Small Saving Fund, which is nothing but the PF, you can say, which will be with the government. So when the government has to take money from this National Small Scheme Fund, it has to give more interest rate. Because the PF or the National Small Scheme Fund, actually this will give more interest rate to the customers. You can say the Post Office Saving Fund and the PF, they will be giving a much higher interest rate to the customers. Okay, so when the agency is giving high interest rate to the customer, it will charge high interest rate on the loans it is giving. So that is the reason the government now is borrowing more from the market rather than the National Small Saving Fund, because of the interest rate issue, as I told. And the loan from the center are decreasing over years and is only 0.37% of total liabilities in 2019. Okay, so the loans have decreased, but 2020 has changed everything. This 2020, actually, you know, the loans of the government has increased, the expenditure of the government has increased, the revenue of the government has decreased, the growth rate has decreased. So this COVID-19 has caused a lot of misery to the economy, which has been already on the declining trend in the past few years. Okay, now let's move on to the next news. So the next is about the types of government debt. So there are various kinds of government debts that we have. The first one is the internal debt and next one is the external debt. So internal debt, if you see in the public debt, so public debt is the debt taken by the government. So in the public debt you have internal debt and external debt. So internal debt, you see, internal debt means the government taking money from the market in the country, from the market in the country, market or RBI. That means within the country, the debt within the country is nothing but internal debt. The external debt is the government taking money from outside country. Okay. So in this you have the marketable debt and non-marketable debt. So marketable debt, if you see the marketable debt, it means the dated securities which can be marketed or which can be sold by the people who have taken these securities. For example, the government dated T-bills, you can say. So they can be sold via auctions. So they are called the marketable securities. Next you have the non-marketable debt. So what is this non-marketable debt? For example, the T-bills, the short-term T-bills issued to the states, okay, they cannot be marketed. And also the securities which are given to the National Small Saving Fund. National Small Saving Fund means the Post Office Saving Fund and the PF, you can say, Provident Funds. So here, the National Small Saving Fund, the government will give the security to NSSF and the government will take money. So they cannot be marketed. You can say they cannot be marketed, so they are non-marketable. And also the securities which are issued to the international financial institutions. Okay, so they also are non-marketable. Next you have the external debt, means the debt taken from other agencies, from the external agencies outside country. Okay, so the other liability, what other type of debt is the debt what the government incurs. It comes under other liabilities, which are nothing but, you can see here, just a minute. Yeah, you can see here the PF, the reserve funds and deposits and other accounts, etc. They come under other liabilities. Okay, so here if you see the recent trends in government debt, the recent trends. So all the debts till 2018-19, so everything has been on declining trend. The debts which the government is taking from all the fields, only the non-marketable debt has increased. The non-marketable debt has increased, but other debts, if you see, they have been on declining trend. Though 2020 has changed everything, but till 2019 everything has been on declining trend, because we have this FRBM act which ensures that the government fiscal deficit is decreasing over time. So when the fiscal deficit is decreasing, then what will happen? When the fiscal deficit is decreasing, then the extra money which the government need also will reduce. When the extra money which the government need reduces, then the loans which the government takes also reduces. So when the loans which the government has to take reduces, then the debt of the government also reduces. Okay, so this is what will happen, right? Now we'll move on to the next thing. Next thing, we have the important definitions. So important definitions, okay, they are very handy, you can say, because these days UPSC is actually framing questions on the definitions also. So the definitions, we have to be very clear. Now we will see what are the important definitions that we have. First one is the debt to GDP ratio. So debt to GDP ratio basically is ratio of country's debt to its GDP. So this debt includes all kinds of debt. This debt includes all kind of debt. Okay, remember this, because tomorrow in exam there might be a statement, in the debt to GDP ratio only the internal debt is calculated or only the external debt is calculated, something like that can be given. So remember this. So it is the ratio of total country's debt to its GDP, and this indicates country's ability to pay back. Because if you see, if let's say for every 100 rupees of GDP, the country is incurring 94 rupees, or you can say the country has 94 rupees debt. That means this debt is serviceable because the revenue is more than the debt. So this is fine. But if you say the revenue is just 100 rupees and expenditure, or you can say the debt is about 150, then that means there is a crisis in the economy, because this debt will not be serviceable, because you have the debts for you are more than the revenue. When the debts are more than revenue, then this poses a risk to the economy. The next one is the rollover risk. So rollover risk is basically risk associated with the refinancing of debt, specifically that the interest rate charged for a new loan will be higher than the old. Okay, so rollover risk, I'll tell you in just, you know, in a short way. Rollover risk is basically rolling over the risk. Rolling over the risk. Let's say there is this company A, and this company A has issued the bonds and it has taken money from the market. Let's say money from the people it has taken by issuing securities. Okay, the securities are for a term of 5 years. Okay, now in this 5 years, this company has not, it did not get the revenue it expected. It did not get the revenue it expected. Now it will need more time. It will need more time. So now, but here what will happen for the money it has taken? The 5 years are approaching. So this company has to return the money to its investors. So as the money has to be returned to the investors, now what this company will do? This company will raise more loan. This company will raise more loan from other sources, and this will be at a much higher interest rate, because the risk for the loan issuing authority is higher, because here the money is being taken to service other type of loans, but not for any investment. So the risk is higher. So as the risk is higher, the interest rate will be higher. But here what the company is doing, it is rolling over the risk to other kind of firm. It is rolling over the investment risk, or you can say the rolling over the debt risk to other firm, and this is called as rollover risk. This is called as rollover risk. Okay. Next one, you have the currency of foreign exchange risk. So currency of foreign exchanges, this we have discussed already, because normally when the money is taken from external agencies and the dollar value, or you can say the exchange rate value varies, then there will be risk in the exchange rate or risk in the currency. Okay. So here you can see the definition. It relates to the vulnerability of the debt portfolio due to depreciation in the value of domestic currency. So depreciation in domestic currency means variation in the money, or you can say variation in the exchange rate. So this will also impact the government's debt servicing cost, because see, let's say the rupee has depreciated. That means we have to give more rupees for the debt which we have taken, the dollars. So that means the government debt serviceability also impacts. Next one is interest payment to revenue receipt. So interest payment means ratio of total interest payment made towards the debt to the revenue received by the government. Okay, so this is the interest payment. Next is floating rate bonds. Floating rate bond means the interest rate varies with time. So there is no fixed interest rate. It is not fixed. Okay, this is called floating rate bonds. Next one, the gross fiscal deficit. So gross fiscal deficit is the excess of total expenditure over revenue receipt. So total expenditure over revenue receipt, and this expenditure includes the loans which the government has to pay, and also the revenue receipts include the external grants and non-debt capital receipts. Okay. Next is the short-term debt of the central government. The short-term debt of the central government, if you see, that the debt which the government has to repay within the next 12 months. This includes 14-day T-bills. Okay, the 91-day T-bills, 182 and the 64 type of T-bills. So every money, every penny or every loan which the government has to return within the next 1 year is nothing but the short-term debt. Okay, so T-bills, if you see, T-bills are nothing but the bonds issued by the central government to manage its short-term needs, and they are issued for a term of 91 days, 182 days and 364 days, and also they are issued for about 14 days. They are called 14-day intermediary T-bills. Okay, these 14-day intermediate T-bills are non-marketable, but these T-bills, the normal T-bills, they are marketable. That means in the market they can be traded, but these 14-day intermediary T-bills are not marketable. They are issued to the state governments and they enable them to deploy their short-term surplus cash at fixed interest rate. Okay, so these banks and other state governments, they will actually give the money to the government so that they will get some return. They will get some return over the excess money what they have. Okay. Now let's see some other developments with respect to the government finance. The first one, the cess and the surcharge. So recently this divisible pool, okay, this divisible pool, which is suggested to be 42%, the divisible tax pool. So this has been reducing in absolute terms. So what does this reducing means? Because if you see in the taxable pool, you have cesses and surcharges also. These cesses and surcharges, both of them, they are not shareable with the state government. They are not shareable with the states. So as they are not shareable with the states will lose the revenue, because recently what is happening is the excise and customs, they were reduced. So as they were reduced, as the excise custom and were reduced, the money which the states are getting has been reduced. And also these cesses and surcharges which are introduced or which are, you know, levied over these taxes, they will not be shared with the states. So states are losing a lot because of this. Okay? And states are opposing this permanent nature of cesses and surcharges. Though they are temporary, the government has been applying these cesses and surcharges from quite some time. Because with this cess and surcharge, for example, the Agri cess, the Swachh Bharat cess, because the central government is entering into the state domain, because agriculture is a state subject and sanitation is a state subject. So with this cess and surcharge, the central government is entering into the state domain, and this is the concern for the state governments. Okay. Next, if you see the government borrowing, so finance ministry, after RBI consultation, has raised about 12 lakh crore for this year 2021-22. So the government has borrowed money. So government will borrow the money through issue of the government securities. Just a minute. Yeah. Issue of the government securities and the T-bills. Okay. So issue of these things, government securities are issued for over 1 year. T-bills are for 91 days, 182 days and 364 days, which we have seen already. Okay. So through issue of these things, the government will raise the revenue. And why the government is raising money is because of the shortfall in tax revenue because of COVID-19. Okay. And there is also slump in the stock market, and this is making disinvestment difficult. The government is not able to reach its disinvestment targets, like government is not able to sell the Air India for a good price and all, which the government is facing currently. And also there is increased expenditure, example 1.7 lakh crore for the relief, income transfer and other support which the government has to give because of the COVID-19 pandemic and others. Now what is the effect of this borrowing on the economy as a whole? The effect, if you see, the borrowing of the government is going to lead to the pressure on the bond market. Okay, and also this is going to lead to crowding out effect of the investments. Now what is crowding out? We have discussed already. That means the money will not be available for the private companies for the investment. Okay, this is the first thing. Second one, there will be high fiscal deficit, and this high fiscal deficit, actually it will not lead to any more stimulus. That means the excess of money which the government has to spend because of the slowdown of an economy, or COVID-19, because of all these things, the government has to spend more. And this high fiscal deficit, that means the high borrowing, is leaving very less fiscal space for the government, to spend more because of the pandemic, right? So these are the effects. See, these effects focus more on these things, because if you see the questions in economy, most of them are analytical based. So the analytical questions are more. So that is the reason you have to focus more on these things. Okay. Now, borrowing limit of the states is the next topic, where recently the central government has raised the borrowing of states from 3-5%. Remember this. Okay. 3-5% of GSDP, the gross state domestic product. Earlier it was 3, now it has been raised to 5, because under the FRBM Act, the 3% cap was there. But now 2% has been increased, that means 200 basis point. So 200 basis point means 2%, okay? Out of this 200 basis point, the 50 points will be unconditional, but 150 points will be conditional. 50 points are unconditional, they can raise, but 150 points, that means 1.5% excess, it is conditional. And it is monitored by the respective ministry. Now, what does this conditional loan raising involves? The conditions, if you see, the 25 basis points for the One Nation, One Ration Card implementation, 25 basis point for the ease of doing business, 25 basis point for the power sector, 25 basis point for the urban local bodies. So the whole of thing will become 100 basis point. And another 50 basis point, if you see, if any of the three criteria are met, any of the three sectors are developed, then this extra 50 basis point can be raised. Okay, these are the conditions that the government has laid. If you see One Nation, One Ration Card, this is mainly to ensure that the people who are migrating or the migrant workers, they can make use of the ration card anywhere of the country. Okay, so they can make use of the ration card to get some grains and all in any fair price shop in any state. Next one, the ease of doing business. If you see, this is mainly to increase the investment in the country. This is to ensure that the norms are followed, the norms issued by the DPIIT are followed, and the state industrial commercial licenses are automatically renewed, and the wholesome process is reduced. Next, in the power sector, if you see the ATC losses. So, on what does this ATC loss means? The aggregate technical and commercial loss. This is basically the whole losses which is faced. The whole losses ka matlab hai, the technical loss, the electricity which is theft, and the inefficiencies. So all of this combinedly called as ATC losses, and these losses are leading to more default payments and all, and this is impacting the distribution companies, the DISCOMs. So the DISCOMs are going into losses. And next one, you have the reduce the ACS ARR gap. So ACS ARR gap means the average cost and average revenue gap, the cost and revenue gap. This is called ACS ARR gap. Okay, and next you have the power subsidy has to be given to DBT. So these are the norms which are expected in the power sector. Next, you have the urban local body reforms regarding water, sewage, and other things, and the taxes. Okay, now we'll move on to the next one. Next one is about the, it is given about the FRBM Act is given. So this FRBM Act is in basically to ensure the fiscal discipline in the economy. The fiscal discipline means the government has to take loans rationally. The loans has to be raised rationally, and it should not be raised just for the election motives and all. Okay, and there are certain targets given by this act. This act has said that 3% of GDP, the fiscal deficit has to be brought to 3% of GDP by 31st March 2021. But now, because of the pandemic, last year in 2020-21, the fiscal deficit is about 9.4%. The deficit is 9.4% fiscal deficit because of the pandemic. So in 2021-2022, the government is expecting fiscal deficit to be about 6.4%. But definitely this can increase because of this second wave pandemic. This 6.4% can increase. Okay, so this is about the FRBM Act. And also, this FRBM Act actually places certain limitations on the government borrowings. How much the government can borrow and from where it can borrow, everything is limited. The government does not have unlimited space. And also monetization, that means the government just cannot print money. The monetization has limits also, cannot print money. These are certain limitations. Now currently in this pandemic situation, all of the economists are suggesting for monetization of deficit, that is printing money and spending, so that there will be more fiscal space for the government, and also there will be no crowding out effect in the market. Okay, so for all of these things, all these economists, they are suggesting for this type of reform, that is monetization. So remember, monetization of deficit means just printing of money and by the RBI and spending by the government, printing and spending. Okay, also the states have their own FRBM acts, but this will be under the major FRBM act of the center. Now let's see the next thing. And guys, here this is a short, this is how our PT-65 summary looks. Okay, so the PT-65 summary we have posted in the Telegram channel also, you can just have a look at it. We are trying to ensure that we reduce the content and give the important content to you. So this will help you in your revision. This will reduce the revision time for you, and this will impact your preparation also. Okay, so here you can see this is the model summary. Okay, this is how it looks. Okay.